I would now like to introduce today's speaker. Robert Henry Farber is the Hughes Rogers Professor of Economics and an associate of the Industrial Relations Section at Princeton University. He graduated from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in 1972, the New York State School of Industrial and Labor Relations at Cornell in 1974, and then Princeton in 1977. In addition to his faculty position at Princeton, he's a research associate of the National Bureau of Economic Research and a research fellow of the Institute for the Study of Labor, ESA. He's also a fellow of the Econometric Society, the Society of Labor Economists, and the Labor and Employment Relations Association. He has written many influential papers in economics journals, top journals, on subjects such as unemployment, the changing duration of jobs, labor supply, labor unions, the ability of workers to change jobs or employers, and other topics in labor economics. He's especially well known for his work on arbitration. He has made many contributions actually not only in labor economics but also in law and economics. And I just want to mention quickly two papers that are some of my favorites, which people in my labor course have seen. One of them is on medical malpractice, which is an area of research that is politically charged and full of folklore and misinformation. In terms of the disinformation in this field, it's somewhere between the level of disinformation about climate change and the historical propaganda about smoking. So, and the best paper that I've read on this subject is by Hank Farber and Shelley White. And basically it finds that there's a strong empirical relationship between negligence and liability for malpractice and the amount of that liability. So, also I recently discovered a paper on why plaintiffs in civil cases lose appeals so often, which I enjoyed very much. It was written by Professor Farber with Theodore Eisenberg. I later learned that this paper I thought it was my discovery, but it turns out that it's won the best paper award from the American Law and Economics Association in 2013, so I guess I can't claim to have discovered it. Professor Farber was also telling me that he made a special trip to Detroit last summer to see the exhibit by Frida Kahlo on his motorcycle. A Triumph 800cc Triumph. So he's an interesting character, and would you please welcome Professor Hank Farber.
Well, thank you. Is the microphone working?
Yeah. Yes.
This is good. If those of you in the back, if things seem awfully small, you might want to move up. There's more seats toward the front, but if you're content to be back there, that's fine too. I want to thank Professor Spurr for the wonderful introduction and for the invitation, and the Levin family for making this possible. I'm really glad to be here today, and as Professor Spurr said, my work is kind of is all over the place in empirical microeconomics, a lot of labor economics, some in law and economics, a little bit in political economy. I work on voting. But I decided in the recession that all labor economists should think about unemployment. And as a result, one of the things I did some work in unemployment insurance, but I became intrigued with this idea, this new technique called an audit study, which I'll describe in a moment, new to me. And I'm going to talk about factors determining callbacks to job applications. And there's some lessons in here, I think, that go beyond talking about unemployment and so on, and about how we do applied work in economics. I'm going to be happy to be walking forward to change the slides. So this is an outline. You'll see this slide several times with different lines bolded. So we'll start with the introduction. There's really no particular need to go through it. The introduction, I just want to talk about just how bad unemployment has been in the Great Recession. The top line is mean weeks unemployed. This is from the current population survey, which is the monthly household survey from which the unemployment statistics are derived. The dashed line is median duration of unemployment. The Great Recession is right here.
And what you can see is that average duration of unemployment for unemployed people had never exceeded about 22 weeks, even in the great, in the deep recession that hit this region of the country particularly hard in the early 1980s, the Rust Belt recession. What you can see is average unemployment duration exceeded 35 weeks in the Great Recession and has since declined, but it still remains above any level seen historically, despite the fact that we've been nominally in an expansion for 6 years. You know, well, if you don't mind, I'm going to digress a little bit on the time. You all read when recessions start and when recessions end. Those dates are simply the result of a committee of my buddies at the National Bureau of Economic Research looking at the data and saying, gee, I wonder when the recession started and I wonder when it ended. And they claim to look at data on economic activity, i.e. the rate of growth of GDP, gross domestic product, and the unemployment rate and employment growth and so on. The fact is they mostly look at GDP growth. And if you think of the economy as a ship sailing along the ocean, and it starts to sink. If it sinks for 2 quarters in a row, the NBER guys say the recession started when the ship began to sink. And then it gets down to the bottom and starts to rise. And once it's risen for 2 consecutive quarters, they say the recession ended when the ship started to rise. That's where the timing comes. Now the problem is, 2 quarters after it started to rise, or when it started to rise, it's not back to where it was. Right? It's not back to the street, it's at the bottom of the ocean, right? And that's the end of the recession. So when I say nominally we've been in an expansion for this long, it doesn't feel that way. Also, as a labor economist, I feel slighted because the labor indicators, like the unemployment rate, lag GDP growth. So the unemployment rate doesn't actually turn up until after the recession has started, according to this dating. And it often continues to rise after the recession has nominally ended. So the peak unemployment in this recession was like in the first quarter of 2010, but the NBER said the recession ended sometime in 2009. All right? Anyway, that's sort of just background. But the point is, clearly bad things were happening in the labor market, and frankly, despite an unemployment rate today in the high fours, or 5%, we're not back to where we were, and that motivates some of this work. This is a plot taking current population survey, matching people month to month, and asking about the exit rate from unemployment, the probability that an unemployed worker found a job by how long they'd already been unemployed. So early in spells, the probability that you find a job is very high, and it declines pretty steadily and kind of levels out after about a year at about 10% of the unemployed each month say they found a job, okay? Now, there's some nuance in here. In particular, it doesn't mean that being unemployed a long time causes you to have a lower exit rate. It might be that there's what we call heterogeneity in the population, and the people who have the easiest time finding a job find a job quickly, and later on in the unemployment spell, you're left with a group of unemployed who are just less able to find jobs generally. But no individual's probability of finding a job change. Just the composition of the pool of the unemployed out here is different from the composition of the pool of the unemployed there. Okay? One of the things we're going to be looking at is age today, and this is a very messy graph of the sort I advise anyone against making. The thing to know is that all the lines move together. The solid line is almost always on top. The solid line, this is the mean duration broken down by age group, and the solid line are the oldest workers. So older workers have higher durations of unemployment. And we're going to explore that a little bit in my study today, okay? So now, there is an existing literature on the effect of unemployment duration on callback. And by callback, what I really mean is on exit from job finding. Okay. And again, it's difficult because of that selection argument I gave you. Because of that selection argument I gave you, this is a hard thing to make a causal inference about. But there's been a new, there's a technique out there now called audit studies. And let me, before I go further, let me just tell you quickly what an audit study is. Okay? Without, I'm going to do this now without a prompt. We use this as a crutch, right? In a sense, I don't really need that. In an audit study, because jobs are posted online now, what you can do is you can look at a job posting and create a fictitious application to the job, create a resume, and send it to the site, and then measure whether that application gets a callback, right? Because on the application, it's going to say, call this number, send an email to this address, and we can monitor those and see if there's been a callback. Then what you can do is in a systematic way, vary the characteristics of the person applying for the job on the resume. So for example, you can say they've been unemployed 6 months, or 1 month, or 3 months. They're 30 years old, or they're 60 years old. That sort of thing, and ask whether the callback rate varies with the characteristics you listed on the resume. That's an audit study. This is on a later slide, but it was pioneered by two economists, Marion Bertrand at the University of Chicago and Sendel Molinathan at Harvard. And what they did was they were looking at the effect of race. So they randomized over the names on the applications and used prototypically African-American names and prototypically non-African-American names, and looked at the callback rates to those two kinds of applications that were identical in every other respect, and found, not going to surprise anyone in this room, that the people with African-American applications, these were not people, these were applications, applications with African-American names got much lower callback rates. But this has now become a much more widely used technique to look at a wide variety of things. We have a postdoc in Princeton who's done some really interesting work on, I don't know if you've heard about, you know this thing about ban the box, whether you can ask about criminal background at the beginning on a job application, or whether you have to ask that later in the process. She's been looking at that. There's sort of lots of stuff. Now, I have to admit, I'm just old and slow. So simultaneously with my colleagues and I, my colleagues Dan Silverman and Till von Wachter, thinking about doing this study, we were scooped. We were scooped by Corey Croft, Fabian Langa, and Matt Nono-Odigdo did exactly the same study we wanted to do. They had exactly the idea we wanted to do, and they got it out and published in the QJE really quickly. Now, if it's in the QJE, it must be true, right? And they did an audit study where they varied the duration of unemployment that was reported on the resume. You don't say on a resume, I've been unemployed 2 months or I've been unemployed 4 months. You list your job history, and it ends a certain amount of time before the date at which you're applying, right? So they find a negative effect of unemployment duration on the resume on callbacks for younger workers. They also look across cities. I'm going out of order here, but I suppose that's fine. The idea about why unemployment duration might affect your likelihood of callback is that employers might make an inference about how good or bad you are based on how long you've been unemployed. If you've been out of work a year, say, this guy might be no good. Why would I want to hire this guy, right? But if you've only been unemployed 2 weeks, say, well, the guy lost his job, let's take a look. That's all a callback needs, take a look, right? Now, what's true is, in a really strong labor market, there might be real information in that, right? If the labor market's really strong and people don't have trouble finding jobs, if you've been unemployed for a year, there might be real information that maybe you're not really a go-getter, right? But if the labor market's really weak, like it was in the Great Recession, you understand there's lots of people who really wanted jobs and couldn't find them because there weren't jobs. So there might be less information when
the labor market is weak than when the labor market's strong. So what they did is they looked in high unemployment cities and low unemployment cities and argued that the signal should be more important. The marginal effect of being unemployed a long time should be more important in the low unemployment cities. And they find that as well. I read that and I said to my co-authors, we're done. They did it. Good for them. It's a wonderful paper. It's one of those papers I said I wish I would have written, and not just because it's in the QJE. All right? Now, it turns out, if you look at the literature, which is not vast, you find a paper by Guyad, who was a graduate student at Northeastern, who does find a negative effect of unemployment duration in the first 6 months for young workers. Nunnally finds no effect of unemployment duration. Erickson and Ruth, working in Sweden, find really no effects for college grads and really no effects before 6 months for the less skilled. So the results turn out to be kind of mixed. In any case, we decided to go ahead with our study and broaden it out beyond unemployment to think about a couple of other aspects of workers as well. To telegraph my answer a little bit, we can't replicate Crofland and Odowadigbo. We don't find what they find. And the last part of my talk is going to be to try to reconcile the two studies and figure out why they get one result and we get another result. And I think there's a general lesson for how we do economics in this. All right? So this, I don't expect anyone to read this. All this is a table of the previous studies. And I don't know why it's a slide, because I challenge anyone beyond the second row to read that. The second dimension that we explore beyond unemployment duration is what you can see what we're going to do. We're going to send out thousands of resumes.
Fake ones.
What's that?
Fake ones. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's a little scary. This is becoming such a common technique, I have to tell you this, that there's a lot of fake resumes floating around out there. Now, we have to, when we do a study like this, we have to get approval of something called the Institutional Review Board. And we have to argue that it doesn't impose much of a burden on the subjects or the companies. And we claim that they hardly look at these things. You know. But I have another friend who's actually one of my colleagues, Alex Moss, and a woman at Harvard named Andy Palace are doing a wonderful study where they're actually posting jobs and actually hiring people. And I can't help but wonder how many fake applications there are chasing fake jobs. In fact, given the sheer size of the labor market, you're going to see that our study is not really big enough to be disruptive. But if this thing keeps growing, might be something to worry about. So there's an existing literature on the effect of age on callback. I believe general evidence that job loss is very costly for older workers. One of the things I've studied over the years is what's called the Displaced Worker Survey, which is a biannual survey of job losers. And what you find is older job losers are less likely to be reemployed by a survey date. And if they are reemployed, they take a bigger wage hit than younger workers. But it's unknown if long-term unemployment is costly for older workers, and only a small literature on the effect of age on the callback rate. Joanna Leahy finds large negative effects of age on the callback rate. And that turns out to be replicated by a big new study by David Newmark, which focuses exclusively on age and finds strong negative age effects for women, but not so much for men, all right? So we're going to be looking at age as well. And finally, to me, this is the most startling result in our paper. The question is, does what you're doing while you're unemployed matter? You're looking for work, but some people, maybe to keep food on the table, take a lower level job than the one they're applying for while they continue to look for work in order to just do that. And this may be jobs for which the individual appears to be poorly matched, lower skill, and well, just to put this in some context, our study is going to be about people we're only going to look at one kind of job, sort of low to mid-level office administration jobs for people with a college degree, with substantial experience in the past, in those kinds of jobs. And we're going to have some of them on some of the resumes that's going to say, I was unemployed for 4 months, and right now, for the last few weeks, I've been working as a clerk or cashier at Target, something like that. We're not having them be McDonald's workers, but we're having them be sort of clerk-style jobs in big box stores and stuff like that. And the question is, what does the employer do with that information? It could go one of two ways. One way it can go is that the employer says, boy, this person's just not sitting around on their rear. They're out there. They're go-getters. I think that's a good sign that they're working. The other way to go is, remember, the employers are looking at these things very quickly. They say, this person isn't working our kind of work. I don't need a person who's a clerk. I need a person who's an office administrator. And they don't read any further. An anecdote about this, I have three children, two of whom lost jobs in the recession. One of them, he's my life gives you lemons, you make lemonade, son. The other one we won't talk about. I love him dearly. And he's doing very well now. But he lost a job, my younger son. And I said, Walter, what are you going to do to find a job? He said, well, Dad, I spend most of my time tailoring my resume to the particular application, particular job posting, because I know that the first stage screening of the resumes is done often by a computer or at least by someone in a big hurry. And they're looking for keywords, and I want to make sure my resume has the right keywords. A natural extension of that is that they look at the most recent work experience, maybe the computer does this, and say, what was the job? Is this relevant? Because remember, for job applications, you get applications from people who are sort of wildly unsuited for the jobs. This happens, particularly in a weak labor market. All right? So it's possible that it's a negative to list this. You might be better off not finding it. So we're gonna take a look at that. It's kind of a nice stark contrast in predictions. Okay, so now, I don't know how much patience this audience is going to have for the Bayesian updating model. So I'm thinking about skipping the formal presentation of the model. But I'm going to kind of, skip is too strong. I'm going to blast through it, which means even the people who want to see it aren't going to understand it. But I will mention, I mentioned as appropriate. Let me tell you what the idea here. In the Bayesian updating model, the employer looks at the resume, which is all the information they have about the individual who's applying for the job, and figure out how optimally to use the information on the resume to form an expectation about how good the worker is. Okay, and I have some math running interference for those ideas on the next several slides. Okay, basically, this is sort of economics talk. Assume a profit-maximizing, risk-neutral firm with a single employee whose output Y is equal to worker quality mu. All that means is the employer's looking for high mu guys because they get more out of it. That's what they get, is mu. And so they're looking for high mu guys. So we're going to assume all potential workers will be paid the same wage. The firm wants to hire the most able worker among the applicants. The firm has what we call a noisy signal of mu, meaning an imperfect signal of mu, how good the worker is, that's based on the information on the application. The signal has many components: work history, education, unemployment experience, age. Think of the employer as using what's called Bayesian updating to derive an expectation based on all of this. Okay, so let's just turn right to this little equation here. Okay, I'm thinking for once. Give me 1 second. I want to think about how much of this I want to go through. Let me bore you for just a couple of minutes. All right. S mu I is the ability of worker I. S I j is the jth signal like imagine the resume has four different signals on it. So one of them, signal J, signal 1, 2, 3, or 4, is literally a function of the worker's ability plus some noise, call it its gamma. And we'll assume the noise is normal, but I don't really need that. So, you know what, I'm gonna tell you, let me tell you what's going on here. The employer is gonna perform an expectation of the ability of the worker based on all the signals S. And that's gonna be in the normal case, I choose a very convenient form, is a weighted average of all the signals on the resume, where the weights in this weighted average are the precision with which the signal reflects the ability of the worker. It's essentially 1 over the variance of gamma, the error term in that equation on the previous slide. Okay, now, what that's gonna tell you, clearly, if it's a good signal and it gets bigger, the information you get is positive. If it's a bad signal and it's bigger, the information that you get is negative. Okay, that's really what's on this slide. Now, remember, let me go back to that one slide. Remember that we think unemployment's a bad signal. So the longer you've been unemployed, the worse the signal. We think age, we're not sure whether age is a good or a bad signal. I'll talk about that in a moment. And we're not sure whether holding an interim job is a good or a bad signal. And that all depends on the sign of that alpha out there. The idea, remember I told you about Croft, Lang, and Noto Odigbo, I'll call them KLN. KLN said that in a weaker labor market, there should be less signal information in the unemployment rate, right? Because being unemployed a long time doesn't mean so much about how good you are if the labor market's really weak. That's equivalent to saying that the weight, remember I said, what the employer, the expectation of how good the worker is based on the signal is a weighted average of the signal. That means in a weak labor market, the weight that you put on unemployment is lower. That's sort of translated into that market. Now here's sort of an interesting idea. The more signals you have, the less valuable any one signal is, because the signal is a weighted average of all, your expectation is a weighted average of all the signals, so the more signals you have, the less important any one is. Older workers may have more signals, because you see longer work experience, right? So it's entirely possible that older workers may, you know, for older workers, anything else like unemployment may be less important. They say, well, the guy's been unemployed a year, but before that he had 30 years of good work experience. So you can imagine that. Okay, here's a final prediction that doesn't quite come from the model. how picky the employer is gonna be, how selective, is going to depend on how many workers he needs to hire. In other words, if he really needs employees badly, he's likely to be less selective. So I'm going to show you some evidence on the question of when an employer hires a larger share of their applicants, are they less selective on the three measures, unemployment, age, and interim job, than if the employer is being really picky and not hiring much at all. Okay, now I've kind of already talked about this. How much any component affects the inference about you depends on two things. One is the precision with which the component provides information about you. And the other is the precision with which other informations, other elements, other components provide information. So this one was about, remember, if the labor market is weak, unemployment has less information. That means it has less precision, so it gets a lower weight. All right, I've already said this in words, I don't need to read it again. Okay, so employers may infer from a long unemployment spell that the worker is not good. So that's a lower posterior mean mu and a lower probability of callback. But if the labor market's weak, there may be less information, smaller effect. So this is a result found by KLN. KLN found that in high unemployment cities, unemployment duration was less of a negative on callback rate than in low unemployment cities. And it motivated our choice of four, we only use 8 cities. They, KLN, use 100 cities. And there's advantages to both approaches. But we chose specifically 4 low unemployment cities and 4 high unemployment cities to try to be able to investigate that directly. Okay. So, what's the role of age? And I haven't really talked about this. You know, what I told you was we understand that older job losers have a harder time. That comes from field data. I can just show you that. It's easy to demonstrate. But what's the argument for that? You can imagine employers would value older workers more because they have more human capital, they have more wisdom, or other attributes that employers value. They're mature, they'll probably show up for work with higher probability, which would imply a higher posterior mean mu, and so a higher callback probability. However, they may value older workers less if they have less relevant human capital. Short time horizons, in other words, they say, gee, I can hire this worker, but they're probably going to retire in 4 years anyway, and I'm really looking for someone who's going to stay a bit longer. Or they may feel like, gee, maybe they'll be sick more than a younger worker, for example. So there's lots of reasons why an employer might say, gee, I'd really rather not hire an older worker. The other thing is, a resume of an older worker has more information on it than the resume of a younger worker. And that could be relevant. You know, frankly, my intuition after doing this study is that employers don't really look at these resumes that carefully. They really weed them out, on fairly surface terms. And you don't want to, as they say in the newspaper business, you don't want to bury the lead on your resume. It better be upfront. Bury the lead. So the bottom line, though, is that there's no clear prediction on age. Now, I can tell you now, I'm going to find a negative effect of age. And all the literature I cited on that other slide find a negative effect on age. Right? Now, what about and I've already told you this, there's those opposing forces on having a low-skill interim job. You might be viewed as a go-getter, which would mean you have a higher posterior mean mu, and then hence a higher probability of callback. Or it may be that because the job is not appropriate for the job you're applying for, you may be weeded out early on in the review process and not get a callback. So bottom line, no clear prediction on interim job. Okay, so now, you know the expression, God is in the details, right? How convincing this can be, it's going to hinge on how we implement this kind of study. So I want to spend a fair bit of time talking about the design of our audit study. You get the idea, we're going to send resumes out, we're going to tailor them in particular ways, and we are going to randomly assign things like unemployment duration, how old you are, and whether you held an interim job. And there's a sense which, if you're not interested in details, I can just read these lines and we can go home. We find no effect of unemployment duration on callback. We confirm a negative effect of age on callback, but there's some nuance to that that I'll talk about. And we find a negative effect of low quality interim jobs on callback. And 4, that other thing I mentioned, we find that firms with high callback rates are much less sensitive to age and interim jobs. In other words, for the firms that are less selective, there's no effect of age and there's no effect of interim jobs. It's only in the more selective firms. All right, so postings, I should say. So that's kind of the bottom line. So the audit study, again, this is a technique pioneered by Bertrand and Mullinathan. It's so interesting to me. I've already said all the slides. I don't think so, though. We vary 3 features of the applications: duration, age, and
interim job. Now, in order, we were trying to eliminate noise from, you know, other kinds of randomness. So we chose a very particular kind of job, administrative clerical jobs. And more than that, all our applicants are female, every one of them. They're all four-year college graduates from, you know, sort of good mid-level state universities, so like from like Wayne State, all right? That's exactly the kind of thing we're looking for. Detroit is not one of our cities. And have substantial experience in low to mid-level administrative office work. Now, in truth, you got to be careful here, and this is Newmark in his study of age talks about this explicitly. The older workers, because they're older, have more experience than the younger workers in our study. They have to. Otherwise, you show them without experience, and they look like they're no good. Right? So they have fairly full employment histories. We selected 8 cities, 4 low unemployment and 4 high unemployment. At the time we selected the cities, it was 2012. And for our low cities, we had Dallas, Omaha, Pittsburgh, and Portland, Maine. And there's a story that hangs on that. And the high unemployment cities in 2012 were Charlotte, North Carolina, Chicago, Sacramento, and Tampa. And by 2014, unemployment had fallen in all 8 of these cities, but the high unemployment cities still remained high unemployment relative to the low unemployment cities. Now, the study took us a long time. It was conducted in roughly 4 waves. And the design changed as we went along because we learned something. For all of us, this was the first time we've done an audit study. So we kind of learned as we went along. The story, interesting story, in wave 3, which took place in early 2014, it won't surprise you to know that we hired research assistants to help us with this. And we told them the cities. And the research assistants in 2014 decided that Portland, Oregon was just as good as Portland, Maine. Oh. or maybe we didn't supervise him well. You know, I don't know. So in wave 3, Portland, Maine is Portland, Oregon. But I delete those observations, and I'll tell you why. One of the ways we do a good job by only selecting a limited number of cities, we're really able to tailor the resumes to the cities with actual addresses of people in those cities, of hypothetical people in those cities, and jobs that might exist in those cities. It's a little sobering that you got some woman applying for a low-level administrative job in Portland, Oregon, with a resume that says everything about Portland, Maine. Right? Because the resumes were in Portland, Maine resumes.
Did they get called back?
And they got called back. They got called back at a lower rate. At a lower rate than the people who were applying in their own cities, about half the rate. But there were still pretty substantial callback, which I found kind of surprising and amusing. Anyway, here's what we're gonna have. We varied specific characteristics of the resumes. Unemployment duration was from roughly 0 to 52 weeks. When I say roughly, resumes don't say how long you've been unemployed. They list dates of jobs. So at the time we wrote the resume and we're planning to be in the field, we would choose a date for ending of jobs that was either 0, 4, 12, 24, or 52 weeks. Earlier. By 0, I mean it was clear the person, the job ended, just because on the resume, you know how you would say, I worked for X from January 2015 to April 2016. That job is ended because it has an ending date. You would just have an open dash if the job is still coming on. It's rather subtle, but that's how you write a resume. And you do that. So that's how you would get the zeros. And that would creep a little bit because it took some time to get the resumes out there. In each wave, we refreshed the dates. But nonetheless, the resumes were sent out over a period of weeks so that, in fact, the duration crept up. But nonetheless,
they really think of them as starting, you know, 0, 4, 12, 24, and 52. The age of our applicants was 35 to 58. That's, to my mind, and something we'll see at the end. I'm going to spend the last part of the talk trying to reconcile my results with KLN. All right? That's an important choice, because virtually all of the other studies have younger workers. All right? And we'll talk about this. Have only younger workers. Interim job at the end of the unemployment spell, yes or no. Interim jobs were sales associate or cashier at a big box kind of operation, or a restaurant server, not a McDonald's restaurant, but a restaurant server. The experiment was in four rounds, as I stated. Two of the rounds were in 2012, and the other two rounds were end of 2013 to mid-2014, and the design changed in each round. In another version of this representation, I have four excruciating slides on the details of each round, but I realized I can summarize those pretty easily. First of all, rounds 1 to 3 have 2 applications per job posting. Round 4, which to me is by far the most interesting round because we can do more with it, has 4 applications per job posting. First of all, with respect to unemployment duration, that was randomized at the application level. So within a job posting in the first round, one of the applications was designated a control application that had 0 unemployment duration, and the other was randomly selected from 4, 12, 24, or 52 weeks. In round 2, we said, forget the control group. Every application was randomly selected from 0, 4, 12, 24, or 52. So there are some jobs where, for example, both could be 0. All right, but each application had a 1 in 5 chance of being one of those values. In round three, it was the same. And in round 4, there were 4 applications for posting, selected randomly from the same five numbers, 0, 4, 12, 24, 52 weeks. Variation in age in rounds 1 to 3 have no within posting variation. In other words, they were both, the ages, I should say, were, there were 3 possible age categories. You could be in your late 30s, your early 40s, or your early 50s. And the late 30s and early 40s, it's like from 37 to 43, are pretty close. The early 50s are like from 53 to 56. And that's much older than the other two groups. And we're going to see that in the data. But in rounds 1 to 3, in any particular job posting, the ages were selected from the same one of those 3 categories. So essentially, there's no variation in age within job posting in rounds 1 to 3. Two applications were selected from young and 2 applications were selected from old. You know, the ages, okay? Interim jobs didn't get introduced until round 3. And in rounds 3 and 4, at the application level, even within job posting, applications either had an interim job or didn't have an interim job, okay? So here's some basic statistics. This is the scale of the experiment. We sent, in total, 4,500 job applications. In round 4, where we sent 4 per posting, we have 6,000 applications, 4 times 1,500. Right? In round 1, for example, we have 2,000 job applications, 2 per times 1,000 job openings. So it's a fairly substantial experiment. We have 12,224 resumes sent to 4,594 job postings. And we have what I think of as a reasonable callback rate of 10.37%. So roughly 1 in 10 applications gets a callback. And if you talk to unemployed people, that's not crazy low. In accordance with our expectation, there's a higher mean callback rate in cities with low unemployment rates, 12.2%, compared to 8.9% in the cities with high unemployment rates. Okay? So now we're going to look at the effects on each of the... Okay, now in fact, the way I sometimes present this is by presenting results category by category. What's the effect of unemployment? And show simple tables. What's the effect of age? What's the effect of entering a job? I'm going to just show you multivariate statistical results and talk about them. The univariate results show exactly the same thing. In a random assignment experiment, you actually don't expect the multivariate results to look any different. So the main findings are, again, I can't say this too often, there's no effect of unemployment duration on the probability of callback. There's a negative effect of age on callback, about 2 to 3 percentage points lower for those 55 and older relative to the 35, well, really it's 35 to about 45, because there's nobody in between 45 and 54, okay? So basically, if you're older than 55, now remember, the average callback rate is 10 percentage points. So 2 to 3 percentage points is a lot. It's a 20 to 30% lower callback rate. That's a big number, right? That's a big number. And if you hold a low quality interim job, you're about 1.5 percentage points. That's about 15% lower likelihood you'll get called back, okay? So my advice to people, if you need to take a job to make some money, don't put it on your resume, all right? And I also am going to find that firms with higher callback rates are less sensitive to age and interim jobs. Now, I have to give you a caveat here. I don't actually know what the overall callback rate is, but I do know in round 4 how many of our applications you called back. You see what I mean? And that can go from 0 to 4. And that's the variation I'm using there. Okay, so the results. All right, so this is a little bit of, I know there's a few economists, excuse me. Okay, I apologize for the technical difficulty here.
That's dying anyway.
Is it dying?
Yeah. The static may indicate that the battery's dead.
Yeah, the battery's gone. Okay.
No, now it's on.
Hello? No. All right, I have a loud voice. I'll just speak up a little bit. Hello? Hello? No. Okay. Okay. All right, anyway, so there's some econometricians in the room. What I'm going to be using is a sequence of logit models. Logit models are models designed for cases when the outcome can be like 0, 1, discrete outcome. That's what we have. You don't get called back or you do get called back. This is as opposed to a continuous outcome like how many years of education do you have. Now, so we'll use a logit model. And I'm going to report results as odds ratios, which I'll talk about, as effects on odds ratios. We'll use what's called a random effects logit model, which accounts for the fact that within a job posting, the likelihood that an application gets called back might be correlated with the other applications to that posting. The employer just isn't very likely to be calling back, so that you might want to take account of that in your analysis. And the third approach is called the fixed effect logit, sometimes called Chamberlain's conditional logit model, where you actually can look, essentially condition on the number of callbacks for that posting. You actually look and say, I'm going to look at the ones with 3. I'm going to look at the ones with 2. I'm going to look at the ones with 1 callback. Okay? And
you know, the way to think about that is, if an employer is calling back one out of four, do they tend to call back the younger guy or the older guy? You know, two out of four and three out of four are kind of the same way. So we're going to present those three models. By the way, in a random assignment experiment, the results shouldn't differ very much across these models, so it's not particularly important. Okay, so these are the statistical results. Now let me tell you how to read this. All right. The numbers not in the parentheses are the estimates of the marginal effects on the odds ratios. If they're one, that means there's no effect. If they're greater than one, it means the callback rate is higher. If they're less than one, the callback rate is lower. And the numbers in parentheses are the standard errors of those estimates. But what I want you to see is these four variables represent 4 weeks unemployed, 12 weeks, 24 weeks, and 52 weeks. And what you can see is they're all very close to one. You see that? In all three columns. And the standard errors, for those of us who think about those, are quite large. So you can't reject the hypothesis that there's no effect of unemployment duration on the likelihood of callback in the logit model, in the random effects logit model, or the fixed effect logit model. By the way, note that the fixed effect logit model is only looking at 1,604 applications instead of the 12,000. Because in the fixed effect logit model, there's no information for the postings where there's no variation in the outcome. And many, many postings got no callbacks. And they just don't contribute to that analysis. There's a couple of postings where they had four callbacks. Or in the case where there's two postings, most of those had no callbacks. A few of them had two callbacks. And there's no information because you're looking within a posting. And if there's no variation in the outcome, you can't learn anything about which one got called back, right? So the sample's smaller. Intriguingly, let's now go, what I've already told you is that in none of the models is the odds ratio different from one, the odds ratio estimate different from one for the unemployment variables. But look at the age variable. If you're 55 to 58, these are substantially and statistically significantly less than one, which means the probability that an older worker gets called back is substantially lower. In fact, if we take either the random effect or the fixed effect logit estimates, which are roughly identical, the odds are about 43% lower that you'll get called back if you're an old guy. Now, these are old guys. These are women. I mean, I call them old guys, but if you're an old guy, right? 43% lower. And similarly, for an interim job, in every one of the models, the people with an interim job are substantially less likely to get called back, about 27% lower probability of being called back if you've listed on your resume that you've held an interim job. Now, those are big effects. Those are really big effects and quite well determined. And the unemployment variables are saying relative to having no unemployment, it doesn't matter how much unemployment you have. All right. So those are sort of the core results. And I can show you know, and if I showed you the means, it would show you exactly the same. You know, the univariate analysis would show you exactly the same thing. Okay, this is an illustration. This now just looks at round four. Round four, remember, I love because it's got four applications per job posting. Okay. So overall, I am just looking at the postings for which there's variation in the outcome. In other words, so I eliminated from this analysis all postings with no callbacks out of four and all postings with four callbacks out of four. There's only a handful of four callbacks out of four. But and the idea here now is to say, look, really I want to compare these three columns. I want to say, where there's one callback, who do they tend to call back? We're just looking now within the posting, and where there's one callback, it's a little noisier. There's 600 600 applications, two postings with one callback. So what does that mean? 150 postings had one callback. And remember, we sent over 1,500 postings, right? And only 150 of those had one callback. And what you can see is, again, there's a bit, now the effects of age and interim job are huge. I mean, look at that. It's only 0.373, which suggests that the odds ratio is over 60% lower. And for an interim job, it's over 50% lower if you had an interim job. If I then look at the case where there's two callbacks, now there's only 340. 340 divided by 4 is 85. There's only 85 postings with two callbacks out of 4. Remember, this is, again, out of 1,500 postings. And you can again see, I mean, it's interesting that the unemployment numbers are actually greater than 1. They're not statistically significantly different from 1, but there's certainly no evidence that unemployment hurts here. Older workers still have a much, much lower probability of being called back, but interim job doesn't seem to matter. This is where the employer's getting, as we move from this column to the two callback column to the three callback column, the employer's becoming less and less selective, right? By the time he's calling back 3 out of 4, I'm interpreting that as meaning they need a lot of workers, they're gonna hire many of the people, they're really interested in pursuing many of the people who apply. And then when I get to 4 callbacks, neither age nor interim job matters. See that? Neither age nor interim job matters. That's where my conclusion, that when the employer is being really picky, this is when they key on things like how old you are and whether you had an interim job, but where the employer's not being very picky, they're not paying any attention to those things. So that's how, you know, the average callback rate by construction is 75% here, it's 50% here, it's 25% here, and remember, the sample as a whole, it's 10%. And what that means, again, is that most postings get no callbacks. Most applications to most postings get no callbacks. By the way, I'm happy to entertain questions. We'll have time for questions at the end for sure. But if anything I'm saying is unclear or whatever, I'm happy to try to clarify. All right, that's really what I've now done is presented to you the results of my study. What I want to do now, you know, I have to admit, the QJE is the highest cited journal in economics. And I was only being half facetious when I said earlier that if it's in the QJE, it must be true. Right? So this is the Quarterly Journal of Economics, for those who are not in the club. The idea here is to say, what is different about their study that might be driving the difference in results that they're finding, we're finding? I've had the honor of discussing their paper. They've had the honor of discussing my paper. We've talked about this extensively. It's the right way for science to be done. We're really trying to figure out what the differences are. So they graciously made their data available to us. And what we did is we reanalyzed their data in ways to make their sample more comparable to ours, to see whether if it's difference in choices that we made in design that are driving the difference, okay? And that's gonna be basically what the rest of the talk is about. So the question is why? They find the probability of callback declines with unemployment duration. Remember, they're not about age, they're not about interim job. The only thing I'm talking about here now is our lack of a finding of the effect of unemployment duration. So the important differences are at least 5 of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them. One is the outcome measure they use is different from ours. We say, did you get called back at all? The way we did this, we set up dummy phone numbers,
and dummy email addresses. And you know, if you called the phone, if an employer called the phone, they got a recording or asked to leave a message. If they left a message, that's a callback. If they sent an email, that's a callback. And we would have our people politely call back and say, I'm sorry, I've taken another job. But KLN had a more stringent callback criterion, which is, did the callback include a request for an interview? Now, luckily for us, in their data sets they made available to us, they also provided, was there any callback at all? So I'm going to reanalyze their data using our callback measure. You know, did you get any callback at all? Job type. KLN used three job types: sales, customer service, and administrative clerical. We use one type, low to mid-level administrative jobs, which is roughly equivalent, based on our examination of their resumes and ours, to our jobs. So we're going to reanalyze their data just on this third category of application, which turns out to be several thousand, so there's a lot of theirs, and we'll look at that. Timing. We're not going to be able to do much about timing because we don't have a time machine. Right? Their study is done earlier in the recession than ours. Actually, in fact, all of this is post-recession by the MBER standards, as I described before. But their applications were 11 and 12. Ours went from March 12 to August 2014. We're not going to be able to say much about that. Choice of cities. KLN used the 100 largest U.S. metropolitan areas. We used 8 selected cities. It turns out 7 of our 8 cities are in the 100. The only one that isn't is Portland, Maine. I like Portland. My brother lives in Portland, Maine, so I use that. So we're able to reanalyze KLN's data for the 7 cities of theirs that are our cities, and compare that to our results, okay? Finally, there's the age of the workers. KLN studied younger workers. They're aged 19 to 40, with 83% 23 to 31, and 98%, in fact, it's a better statistic for my purposes, better statistic, 98% are less than 35. And our sample has no one younger than 35. And it's entirely possible that you might think about younger workers differently from older workers. There's not a hell of a lot I'm going to be able to do about that, but I do have some analysis of that. All right, so let's turn to our analysis of the KLN study. So which design differences could account for the results? The outcome measure, it's not clear, but we can look at that easily enough. The job type could matter, right? It's possible. Now, first of all, I should say all our applicants are female. KLN's applicants are not all female, but for the job category of administrative clerical, 97% are. And in fact, I think when we analyze that category, I eliminate the men too. So I'm looking at the 97% of KLN's administrative clerical category who are female. So that's a good one. We can really do that. It could matter, but it could matter in unspecified ways. And there's going to be an overarching lesson I'm going to draw from the fact that they find different results from ours when we get to it. Timing could certainly matter. KLN is earlier. We're later. KLN's early in the recovery. Now, here's the problem with that as an explanation. We think labor markets are tighter later in the recovery, which means unemployment ought to matter more, not less. Right? Remember what I said was, in a strong labor market, unemployment duration should have more signal value than in a weak labor market. So by rights, this would be a great explanation, theoretically, if it was flipped and they didn't find anything and we did. Right? But the way they found it, their theory, and frankly my theory, is that It should matter in the opposite direction, so it's probably not, there's not much I'm going to say about that. City choice is not likely to matter, and we'll compare results. There's nothing obviously weird about the 8 cities I selected. I don't think. And finally, the age could matter. For example, the longer employment history of older applicants could make unemployment a less salient feature of the resume. You know, it's just there's more other stuff, on the resume. But we will use KLN's data to investigate how their callback rate varies with age in their restricted range, in other words, from 20 to 35, and see what we can learn. But nonetheless, our sample doesn't start till 35 and older, so there's not a heck of a lot we can do with that. Okay, so in order to keep this manageable, we're going to use an extremely simple model. It's not the Logit odds ratio model with everything included. All we're going to do is regress it's going to be a Logit model. We're going to predict the probability you got a callback as a function of, I think it's the unemployment duration in months, just a linear variable. How many months have you been unemployed? Okay. And we're going to do this for various permutations. So here's a sample of what we do. FSVW, that's us, Farber, Silverman, Von Wachter. Okay? We have 12,224 applications. As I told you before, we had a 10.4% callback rate. And the marginal effect of unemployment in months from the Logit model on the probability of callback is 0.4 zeros and a 1 with a standard error that's 61 times that, right? So there's no evidence that's not statistically significant. There's no effect of unemployment duration on a callback. And in fact, it has the wrong sign, right? The KLN variable that they prefer, callback with an interview, they have 9,236 applications. They had a callback rate of 4.54%, which is low. But they get a significant negative effect of unemployment in months on the callback. This is the marginal effect on the probability of callback. So it suggests that 10 extra months of unemployment reduces the callback by about 0.8 percentage point, which is about 10% to 15% of the callback rate. All right? But if I use the more expansive definition of callback in the KLN data, has a callback rate now of 12.05%, now when you run that model, 10 months of unemployment reduces the callback rate by about 1.4 percentage points, which is quite a lot, right? So the lesson with this is that the difference in the definition of the callback rate is not the driving factor in the difference in our results, right? It just can't be. It's significant even when I use a measure like our measure. Okay. Now, what if I restrict the analysis? This is a replication of the last line of the previous table. Now I just look at the 2,690 applications to women applying to administrative and clerical jobs. An intriguing fact is their sample of administrative clerical workers has a much lower callback rate than ours. We're now using the common callback variable. It doesn't have to have an interview. And they only get a 3.61% callback rate. We had a 10.4% callback rate. But even with that low callback rate, they're still finding a negative marginal effect of unemployment duration on the callback. Their result is there even for that smaller subgroup of our sample, of their sample, okay? All right, I've already talked about this. Timing, the time period, again, the theory goes in the wrong direction. We're later, the labor markets are stronger, we ought to find a bigger negative effect of unemployment, not a weaker negative effect of unemployment. Now let's look at our cities. It's astounding, really. I can drop their apps from 9,236 to 1,130. You know, that's like 12 or 13% of the original sample. And I still get for the KLN data, a significant, marginally significant negative effect of the callback rate, of unemployment duration on the callback rate. So it's not the cities. It's not the cities. It's not the definition of the variable. It's not the type of job. What does all this mean? So, age. The age is hard because, remember, there's no overlap. But nonetheless, if I break the KLN sample into the really young guys, pretty young, slightly older, and then people in their 30s, it's not statistically significant in every group. And in the very young, at first I looked at the first and I said, we're into something here. For the youngest guys, it's the large negative effect, right? If you have substantial unemployment and you're really young, you're not going to get called back. That's what that's saying, right? But 23 to 26, it's not statistically significant, but then it starts to get bigger again. 27 to 30, it matters. 31 to 39. Now, all the people 31 to 39, almost all of them are less than 35. There's very few people in their late 30s. And this is statistically significant. The 27 to 30 years, statistically significant. Basically, I would have liked a monotone declining marginal effect. If it was declining throughout, I could say it's probably age. And we just have older guys. But the fact that even for people in their early 30s, which is what really is dominating this, it's still significantly negative. I can't really conclude that. I still think, the conclusions, the choice of cities and job types are probably not important. Time period may be important, but again, it goes the wrong way. Age may be important. And I think, to me, I actually conclude from this, age, I think, is the key. They're much younger. And the conclusion is, perhaps the KLN result doesn't generalize to older workers, just as our result doesn't generalize to younger workers. Now, when we first got to this point, I said to Dan and Till, my co-authors, let's go back in the field and do a study with a full spectrum of ages, a common study, to get rid of all the interfering stuff. And we said, no. I actually have come, the general lesson is that experiments, and I think maybe other kinds of studies as well, are really have limited external validity. External validity means the extent to which the results can be extended outside the sample group that you've done the estimation. If you asked me, based on my study, do interim jobs hurt for people who are applying for jobs as material handlers at warehouses, I would say I have no idea. I only can conclude that if you're applying for office work, it looks like it's a bad thing, right? And similarly for age, I only know for this type of job. Too many of us read a study, like KLN, it's not that they don't, if you read the conclusion to their paper, they make a caveat, say, look, we're only looking at young guys. We don't know if this will hold for older guys. They're not overclaiming, but it's out there, because it's in the QJE. One of my students is the editor of the QJE. It's a wonderful journal. I published there last year. I was pleased to do it. I'm simply saying that when something is published and has that imprimatur, people will tend to extrapolate it beyond maybe what you ought to do. So a caution for all of us is to be very careful in this kind of thing. For me, the marginal benefit of doing a study that took all the ages was not high enough to let me do it. I did some work published in the QJE on the labor supply of New York City taxi drivers, which some of you may have seen. And what it does is it tries to contrast different models of labor supply and ask whether the standard neoclassical model is appropriate for taxi drivers, or what's called a model with reference-dependent preferences in behavioral economics is relevant. Without giving that paper, I came down strongly on one side of that, which is that people seem to be using the neoclassical model. Reference-dependent preferences are not terribly important for taxi drivers. And the question then is, am I willing to say that reference-dependent preferences are not important anywhere for labor supply? And the answer to that is probably no. But I have people coming to me and say, I read your paper, I knew reference-dependent preferences were garbage. And I think that's subject to the same limitation here. Until you do one other thing, and this is the way out of it, is you say to yourself, we need to understand the mechanism that makes this important in this setting. What is it about the setting here that makes it important? Which, in a sense, I was a failure at that, because I tried to isolate the differences between what KLN did and what we did, and I couldn't find the differences. In my taxi driver work, I've concluded that it needs now another application to figure this out. I said, in places where people are barely earning a living, taxi driving is not a way to become rich. You know, I analyzed the data on every trip taken in every taxi cab in New York for 5 years. That's almost a billion trips. Right? I've got best data there can be on this. And I realized these drivers are in a, I wouldn't quite say subsistence, but they're in a very low income occupation. And they need to earn money efficiently. And efficiently means behaving neoclassically. It means not responding. Reference-dependent preferences in the shorthand, it means you set a daily income target, roughly, and you drive until you reach that target, and then you go home. That means on days when it's easy to make money, you go home early and leave money lying in the street. And on days when it's hard to make money, you work longer and bang your head against the wall, right? Clearly, you can make more money in less time turning that around. And that's what a neoclassicist would do. So I have a theory there that says you might see reference-dependent preferences in places where there's not, if you will, market pressure. But in places where there's market pressure, you're going to be less likely to see that. But we don't have that kind of story here yet. We don't know in this unemployment callback setting what's driving the core result. And we have interesting patterns. As I said, frankly, if it was KLNF, actually given alphabetization, it would be FKLN. If it were FKLN and we got those results, I would have declared victory, slammed the book shut, published it in the QJE, and gone home. Right? But for me, this was, when I saw their paper, I said, we're done. And then I realized there's a more important fundamental lesson about how we learn in economics in the comparison of these studies. And I'll leave you on that note. And I'm happy to talk, answer questions, whatever you want. Okay, thank you.
If you answer questions,
Sure.
To you.
Sure. I'm going to unplug this, so do something to save the battery.
So the floor is open for questions from anyone?
Yes.
Mine is not really a question, but a comment. So you mentioned this little accident about Portland and Portland.
Yes.
And I just know in my PhD labor class, we cover some work that looks at the plight of the trailing spouse and the fact that they tend to have lower earnings. And so I'm just saying, of course, it's not perfect, the data that you already have, but it's, hey, way better than nothing. Because it seems like maybe their callback rate, when all of their experience is in a different city than where they're applying, maybe just from the short bit that you said about it.
You're asking why is it that in Portland, Oregon, the Portland, Maine women didn't get higher enough callbacks?
Yeah, so I'm just saying if there's a difference there between, of course, you would like, obviously, if you were going to look at that question, to have women, you know, in applying for jobs in some city, some of them with their experience from within that city and some from somewhere else, but just from the little bit of information you have.
Well, you know, there's other evidence of this. I was just talking about a study I think I want to do with one of my friends at University College London, Christian Dustman, about, you know, there's a famous paper in labor economics by Topel and Ward, which shows that for young men, most of their wage growth happens when they change jobs, or at least more than half their wage growth. It's very well known, an old paper. I'm so old, I refereed it. The I had a graduate student many years ago who said, let me replicate their result, and let me try to replicate it for women. And she found out that women changed jobs as much as men, but didn't get anything for it. And that's sort of a trailing spouse kind of idea. So that's a great comment, that's a great idea, but I don't want to design a study that's meant to get exactly at that. And so what Christian and I are going to do is try to see with sort of more modern, longitudinal, better data, see if we can make more progress on that question. So I think the trailing spouse issue is like really important. You know, now, what's true is, for less educated people, they don't move around as much. So I'm not sure it's going to be as relevant for them as for more educated couples. And one could also try to figure out if it's about sex or about who's trailing. Because you could also, in some cases, identify who the trailing spouse is, and predominantly is the female, but it's not always. Yeah?
I'm just wondering, is there a time trend in this effect of age, do you think? I mean, I was just thinking about the fact that there are two different things there. Older people live longer, older people are more healthy, so that should make being old less of a handicap. But on the other hand, if the rate of technical change is speeding up,
yeah,
maybe that's a bad thing for hiring an older worker. I mean, do you have any speculation about that? Or?
Can I tack on to that also while you're on that
sure.
point? I would have also thought that older, especially since you're focusing on women, that among older women, they're more likely to have their kids grown. So they don't have that distraction of young children going on that the younger women would have. You would think that employers would appreciate that.
Yeah, you would.
Potentially.
Right? No, that's certainly true. No, I agree with that. I don't know what to say about technological change. It's, you know, I don't know. You can imagine an employer in an office administrative setting having a preconception that a woman or a man, even 55 and older, isn't going to know much about computing, for example, how to use the desktop applications and so on. I'd rather get a younger person who kind of grew up with the technology. So, but, you know, what you raise is exactly the kind of issue that ought to be stimulating for someone else to go and design a different study that gets exactly at that question. Our study's not designed to do anything but allow me to speculate on that. Right? And I'm always a person who engages in, I hope, in limited speculation. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Is there, I know you said your findings were close to the real world, but is there any data on whether or not companies can determine fake resumes from real ones, or if they care to?
It's interesting. I don't even know if the companies realize there's fake resumes out there. There are people who are starting to work with the companies that post these things. And I don't know how they would figure out I don't know how they would figure out the resumes were fake. It's a bit startling that you raised that one because I haven't thought about it. I think, you know, frankly, one of the things I'd like to do, particularly to get out the interim job result, is I'd like to contact companies that post and ask them how they screen resumes. You know, what actually is, get inside the process of how the resumes are interpreted, right? And that would help us design better studies, but also really try to understand some of these results. You might also be able to guide people in designing their resumes to avoid these kinds of pitfalls. But it's a good question, yeah.
Most of this, from my understanding, that most of the candidate management systems are the ones who do the screening. So it's, like our son was saying, it's keywords. So what they do for the candidate management system is they input the characteristics or the criteria of which they're looking for. And this is how they go through massive amounts of resumes that are inputted into their organizational databases. And then further, 98%, department there that are sourcing through LinkedIn. So they're also looking at sourcing candidates through that way as well. So.
Yeah. You think these jobs are LinkedIn type jobs?
No.
Really?
Yep.
Now, I will say this about myself. I should also, to brag, but he got a better job than the one he lost. And, you know, he was very effective at this process, but he's pretty savvy. He kind of works in that business. And yeah, it's an interesting, what would you have me do? What would you do?
Well, regarding the interim jobs, I do believe it is a technical issue more so, specifically because of the way technology and the development of certain, even an administrative level, one of the criticisms I hear a lot is whether or not they really know PowerPoint or really know some sort of technical skill. And just in general, I think it's what, 3 months in the technical world is how quickly you become outdated in the technical world.
If that's true, you ought to see unemployment be a big problem, right? Because if you've been unemployed 6 months, it means your skills are no good.
Exactly. Well,
so one thing I did not talk about is this depreciation of skills argument. Right? And, you know, that actually, to tell you the truth, not in these audit studies, but in the longer literature on broader literature on long-term unemployment, there's a lot of talk about depreciation and obsolescence. And we struggle with good ways to measure that. There is the government has I want to call it a database of occupational characteristics broken down in excruciating detail on the very narrow types of skills the jobs require. It's called ODET.
Well, of course, I'm very familiar with ODET.
Yeah, okay.
It's not excruciating, but yes, it is as comprehensive as the U.S. government can get.
That's right. It's not perfect. But you can imagine trying to use the ONET characteristics of a particular job to figure out just how prone to depreciation the skills are in that particular job, right? And then try to design a study around that.
Well, and keep in mind that, I mean, I should qualify.
I can already see, you know more about this than I do.
Well, the three of us are in career services.
I see.
We're helping out a daily basis.
Okay.
But I'll use ONET or many of the other government resources to help candidates source and things of that nature, but because those are the most reliable data that's out there.
Yes.
Meaning there's not a lot of consistency, and the U.S. government has done the labor mistake, you know, going through and normalizing that data. The problem is it takes them about, you know, 2 to 3 years. I think the last time on the Occupational Look Handbook was updated, it took 5 years to update that data. And what we see in the labor market is the information is changing on a sometimes monthly basis.
Has anyone ever tried to figure out that by the time the Occupational Outlook Handbook comes out, how well did it do? In other words, you can go forward and ask.
Where the projections are?
Yeah.
Put it this way, no one projected the internet. Or the impact of the internet. You go back and look at their projections for back then.
Right.
Or they also, when you look at projections, their projections don't necessarily look at regional areas. So we're still seeing people coming in saying, oh, we got to go into nursing or healthcare because healthcare is hot. They're not taking into account with the economies in Michigan that we have a, you know, status here and that there's just, you know, we have graduate nurses that can't get jobs because they don't have the 3 to 5 years of experience that employers require.
They just need to move somewhere else and they'll find a job, no problem.
Yeah. But, you know,
maybe you just can't stay in Michigan. I know that's hard. One thing you can do to project, you know, there are certain facts that we know that really could be very important for projecting the labor market, but just demographics, the aging of the population, you know, says many things about the kinds of jobs that we needed, right?
Yes.
But,
and that's where they get a lot of that, but
right.
Especially with the technology aspect and the many of the types of new jobs that are emerging from that, those are very hard to predict.
Sure, fair enough. Yes, ma'am.
Can I do a terrible, shameless self-promotion plug? And Nanette mentioned that we do a lot of work with LinkedIn. We do webinars and on-site events. Monday afternoon at 4, right here in this room, we're going to do 2 sessions. The first session is to help students articulate their experience on their LinkedIn profile. And then the second is for people who are in mid-career
and want to make a change. There's a link to register. If you don't want to go through all that hassle, just please come as my guest next Monday, 4 o'clock here. Thank you so much.
To link this, if you will, to what I'm talking about, maybe you want to think a little bit about, depending on what kind of job they're looking for, what information they ought to be leading off their LinkedIn profile.
Yes. That was huge when you mentioned that. Thank you so much.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
How much of an effect do you think intermediate jobs have on more younger applicants?
To be honest with you, do you think
that it affected KLM's
results? They didn't have any intermediate, interim jobs. And I am really, in the spirit and being consistent with my talk, I really feel like I shouldn't try to extrapolate from what I did on that to younger workers. I just don't. If you ask me as a citizen, not as an economist, but a different hat, I would think that for a very young worker who essentially has no experience at all, showing any kind of ability to hold a steady job is probably a good thing. You know, one of the things that they talk about in the poverty and training literature is that people are reluctant to hire disadvantaged youth, for example, because they don't know how to hold a regular job. So anything, or the claim is they don't know how to hold a regular job. So anything you can do to show that, yes, you've been a reliable guy, even in a lower level job, might be useful. But I don't have it. That's not a scientific statement.
One of the other things is, first of all, it's not just paid work experience. Projects, those are going to be important. Any kind of consistency or skill building activities. So that, and the other part that was interesting is the assumption here of longevity in positions when the nature of work is very temporary today. And one of the things we used to tell people is you had to get in the job and stay there to show that you're reliable and that you're faithful and consistent. Well, that's not seen as a desirable trait anymore. That's seen as less of a risk taker, and more employers are wanting risk takers. So short-term employment is not necessarily a bad thing on a resume anymore.
Interesting. Let me tell a story that's consistent with that. Professor Sperr mentioned that I'm a graduate of RPI, Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, and the engineers I went to school with all thought they would have died and gone to heaven if they get a job with GE or IBM and stay a career. Those are both upstate New York companies. And I went back and gave an alumni lecture there about 10 years ago. And I talked to some of the undergrads. None of them had the least idea that that would be something that they want to do or is possible even. And that life is a series of jobs. And Robert Reich, who was Secretary of Labor in Clinton, the first Clinton administration,
Ahead of yourself.
That's right. Anyway, let's not go there. It's just too depressing. Said that he's not looking for employment. He's not looking for job security. He's looking for employment security. And Alan Krueger, my colleague at Princeton, and Larry Katz at Harvard have a new study of contingent work, which is showing a big increase in the fraction of the population in the kinds of jobs you're talking about. It's still a substantial minority of employment, but it is. I'm just saying in this national statistic.
I was going to say, look at your industry. You're calling contingent staff in healthcare. They call it project engineer manufacturing.
Right.
They call it adjunct faculty in
higher ed. Right. No, absolutely. Absolutely. So that's certainly growing, and people are worried about it. We're going to see a lot more work on that in the near future. Anything else? I've got plenty of energy left. Thank you very much.